Professor Peirce received her PhD from Princeton University Near Eastern Studies Department in 1988. She has held professorships at Cornell, UC Berkeley, and now at NYU, where she is Silver Professor of History. I love that. It's like silver fox. She is, as I'm sure you all know, one of the most important figures in Ottoman, the study of Ottoman history today. She's published two already classic books, The Imperial Harem, published by Oxford University Press in 1993, which won the Turkish Studies Association's Mehmet Fuat Kurkulu Book Award. And then in 2003, Morality Tales, Law and Gender in the Ottoman Court of Aintab, published by the University of California Press, which won the most important book award in Middle East studies in any discipline, the Albert Barani Memorial Book Award. It's, as I'm sure most of you know, an in-depth study of one register of the Muslim law court in Gaziantep, what was then called Aintab in southeastern Turkey. And it's really remarkable for the way it sheds light on what this register can tell us about all kinds of things about the society, Ottoman society and Gaziantep society more specifically. She currently has a book in press, just got the proofs, right? A biography of Hürrem Sultan, the topic of her talk today, known in the West as Roxolana, the famous or infamous wife of Suleiman I, known in the West as the Magnificent. This book is for a broader, more popular audience, and it's being published by Penguin, is that right?
Basic books,
okay, even better. And so her talk today will be related to that book, and I'm sure you want to go ahead and get to it, so I will shut up and turn the floor over to Professor Peirce.
First, I'm going to thank Jane for being my friend and colleague and getting me through all kinds of scrapes and being somebody I consult and everything. So thank you, Jane. I want to thank everybody to do with the Center for Historical Research and this project who invited me. And I just learned your names and I'm trying to repeat them. And I'm really happy to be here. And thank you so much. And I thank all of you for coming. Okay, so my topic today is the dynamics between family and sovereignty among the Ottomans. And my principal subject has already been introduced. She was known to the Ottomans as Hürrem, and as Jane has pointed out to European audiences, as Roxolana. And I'll explain that later. So if I slip and call her Roxolana, it's the same person. In the book, she's Roxolana. Her own given name is not known because she was abducted from outside the Ottoman lands as a young girl. She's an Orthodox Christian girl. At some point, she was sold into slavery. She ended up in Istanbul, and she came into service in the palace that housed the women and family, children of the imperial family. The Sultan lives in a different palace, and I'll come to that later. Her talents were apparently noticed, and if she had not already been converted to Islam, she was there in the palace. Hürrem entered Ottoman history when she was selected as a concubine for Suleiman I, the Magnificent. He came to the throne in 1520, and her first child was born somewhere around a year later, so she became his concubine quite early on. She would apparently be the only concubine, the only woman that he took with for the rest of his life, as far as we know. 14 years after she met Suleiman, after giving birth to five sons and a daughter, Suleiman made her his wife. Two cardinal rules of Ottoman reproductive and dynastic politics were broken here. Concubines were to produce only a single son, not five, and I'll explain the rationale for that later. And sultans did not marry their concubines. And marrying a concubine entailed freeing her first. So the date is imprecise. I think it is 1534 when they're actually married. The wedding isn't publicly celebrated for another 2 years, but he would have freed her and then made this marriage. By 1540, a few years later, when everybody's figuring out that things are changing seriously, it was clear that she was becoming a figure with unaccustomed influence. And not everybody was happy with this. We hear about street talk that was accusing her of bewitching Suleiman, otherwise why would he make these changes? And we hear this from European reporters, European ambassadors in their report. So I'll come back to that better in a minute. I will just wind up by saying she went on to become the only queen that the Ottomans ever had. Now, I do want to say that the title queen, there was no coronation, there was no title, but I am using the word queen for her status, and I thought that was pretty risky, but then I was very happy to see that our historian colleague, who has written a lot about patronage, women's patronage, and men's as well, has called her queen. So we're calling her queen for the exceptional status. There was no one to follow her line. She is worth studying. Hürrem is worth studying. I spent the last 5 years studying her. Not only for her maverick career, but because together she and Suleiman set in motion a wholesale retooling of the Ottoman dynastic family and the practices of sovereignty. And this is sort of the core of what I want to talk about. I have been working on this biography of Hürrem for several years. She was not unknown to me because my first book, which Jane showed you, focused on the females of the Ottoman royal household. And I wanted to recover them. We didn't really know their stories. And then I learned that from assembling them all the information we could find, what their stories could tell us about the larger history of the empire. This was a group study. So the challenge of biography, and I should say the challenge of biography, I would start by saying there are not very many models in my field. There are biographies of modern figures, of Abdulhamid II, of Ataturk. There is a biographical study of Mustafa Ali, who was a statesman and a prolific author. But we have all of his texts. Arnold Fleischer has written his book. It's also a classic. It is a classic. But he had lots of texts, and he could know a lot about Mustafa Ali. So what I'm doing here, there's not a whole lot of information, so I'll come to that later. So the challenge of biography. I just couldn't ignore this. I'm not sure this has a lot to do with my talk today, but maybe towards the end, I'm going to get into some of the things we sort of know, but we know, I think I know when I want to talk about. But you just can't ignore the periods of her life for which there is little or no information. And there are many periods in which there is little or no information. That's been a challenge for me to figure out what I could say about these sort of less interesting. I think they are very interesting, but on the surface, you don't have the information. Part of the problem here is that protocols of the period meant that there was little discussion of royal women in Ottoman sources. It's a kind of a respect for, you know, the sort of sanctity of women, or you just never talk about women. It's not. There are European sources, primarily Venetian, not only Venetian ambassadorial reports, but also people who have worked in the Ottoman Empire, traveled in the Ottoman Empire, might be former captives of the Ottomans who served the Sultan. So there's a whole range of materials from the Venetians. Long around the mid-century, we start to get French ambassadorial reports as well. So we do have information, and without that information, this book could not. But these foreign sources, or these European sources, are pretty much interested in her political profile. When things she does, or things that are being said about her, or things that are suspected about her, affect politics, because the nation's very interested in the political situation. Yeah. So they don't tell you much about her domestic or personal life, so it's kind of hard to find. It was a real challenge to fill in those sections. And between us, I do worry, I don't want people in the middle to look like this is getting boring. I was the same thing, right at the end. But we'll see what happens. Anyway, I do worry about that. So, you have to worry about something, right? So, I was really happy when I was invited to participate in this project on family, kinship, and household, sponsored by your Center for Historical Research, which is also a thing. Several key elements of the project description were useful prompts to me for talking about both her public and her domestic life. I don't use public and her domestic lives. Both her public and her domestic life was infused with politics. That's what I was trying to hear. And I want to move here to the concept of household. I think the concept of household underlines this. For several decades now, The huge apparatus of Ottoman government, centered in the royal palaces, but stretching across the empire through the satellite structures governed by high-level statesmen, this huge apparatus has been considered a vast house. I think we've been using the term house for at least 40 years or so. Did you say
35 or 40,
and Jane Hathaway is one of the people who has contributed this discussion. So house. So I think now before, that's my introduction. So now I think I'll just show you some slides so we can get a visual sense. So this is a portrait of the young young Hürrem. It says Rosa Suleimani Uksor, sort of cut off here. And Rosa goes with Roxalana. It means the maid from Ruthenia, from Little Russia. So I'm going to come show you that and get you that. This portrait of the young Suleiman is by Titian Ciano. And I discovered the original. This is all over the internet, but I found where it was in a private collection in Istanbul. And they tell me that it's school of Venice, 16th, 17th century. So that seems to be as much as they know about it from Venice. So now I'm happy that they're both sort of Venetian images. Okay, here's where I want to this is the Ottoman Empire. I don't even really see it, but I really like that. This is a map from my first book. Somebody was smart and put in Poland, Lithuania, because I didn't ask for it. So anyway, here it is, tricontinental. The Ottomans love to talk about the two seas, you know, two lands, two seas, but then they knew what that had to do. So I just want to show you that they started right here. It has a quite small upstart enterprise. So just notice, I call it Lviv, I think it's Lviv today, this major city in the western Ukraine, and we think that she is from this region. So I just wanted to show you the Ottomans and where we think she might have come from. So Ruthenia, which is called Ruth in the days, so she's La Rosa, the lady from Ruthenia. So we think she was abducted from here. Okay, so she was a subject of the Polish king, and who then, you know, becomes the Polish Lithuanian Commonwealth a little later. So let's assume that she's from there. Okay. Oh, I've got my. And so here is Kiev, and let's assume the bulb is over here. So I have to reconstruct this. This was a very difficult chapter to write because I had to tell this whole story about her enslavement and really get readers to understand the difficulty of all this. So she was perhaps, maybe most probably, though you don't really know, marched all the way into the Crimean Khanate here, who were a vassal, quite independent vassal of the Ottomans, and possibly down to this Ottoman-controlled province, where she would have been, and where she would have been purchased, presumably, possibly, by slave dealers. I don't know how she got to Istanbul. Perhaps she was purchased by an agent of the palace. Perhaps she was just an ordinary slave who got to Istanbul and somehow people figured out that she was talented and she rose up and entered the palace. That part of her history we know very little about. All we know is that she ended up in the Ottoman palace. So she would have, I said, the palace that housed the women and children of the family and all of the servants who would take care of them. And it was also, I go into quite a bit of detail in the book here, this is where female slaves were trained and where she would have been recognized as having talent and would have been groomed to be a concubine. At some point they figured out she was good looking. I mean, you need the sultan to want to sleep with her. And that she was smart, because she has to be smart, and we'll understand why she has to be very smart and savvy, and so forth. So the palace is located here, okay? And this is the palace of the Ottoman Sultan. I'm showing you these because later a remarkable fact will happen, that she will leave this palace and go to live there, which is unheard of. Okay, so I think those are, yes, those are top slides. Okay. So I'm going to turn now to the question of family and sovereignty. And I would start by saying that the idea of family is absolutely fundamental to Turkish conceptions of rightful sovereignty. The basic principle here is that all healthy and sane males who are part of the royal family, the dynastic family, are eligible to rule. All male kin are supposed the system should provide equal opportunity for them to become the ruler. This is a political philosophy that the Ottomans share with the Mongols and others. Sometimes this is called Tanistry. Tanistry has a quite wide definition, but this is a particular aspect of it. This is unlike primogeniture, as we know it from Europe, where the eldest is privileged and the junior brothers, the cadet brothers, are sidelined. This is no minor matter, because the Ottoman dynasty is one of the longest-lived royal lineages in history, out of 37 generations of the same bloodline unbroken, from about 1300, which is when they sort of emerge into the light of history, until 1922, when the Sultanate was abolished by the Grand National Assembly of Turkey. I just want to emphasize the lineage aspect of things, and I'm going to just read a short quote from the Byzantine historian and diplomat Dukas, who is writing in the early first half of the 15th century. He says, and the point I want to make is that people were more devoted to the dynastic lineage than to the person of the ruler. I mean, they were devoted to the person of the ruler, the lineage, the character. And here's his quote, very short quote. A subject, he says, easily transfers his allegiance from one ruler to another, so long as both the old and the new sovereign are descended from the line of Osman. Osman is the original, the number one ruler, acknowledged as the number one ruler. So given this longevity of rule, six plus centuries, of one lineage, it's not surprising, I think, that the structures and practices of the royal family had to keep modernizing, and I'm going to use the term modernizing here, to stay on top of both internal and external relevance. The world changes over the course. Oops, I mixed up the pages. Not surprising me. Sorry, I'm just getting my papers wrong. Okay, so that said, I want to come now back to Hürrem and Süleyman, and I think that hindsight demonstrates what I mentioned before, is that their relationship constituted one of the most critical junctures in the evolution of Ottoman governance. Now, how does this system of males should have equal opportunity affect the females of the dynastic family, or rather the mothers? We all know that royal consorts are critical to the survival of the dynastic lineage. They produce the royal heir, right? So from roughly 1400 on, that's 100 years into the Ottoman state, it's not an empire yet. It's not an empire really until the conquest of Constantinople from the Byzantines in 1453. So 100 years into this enterprise, the Ottomans began to reproduce with concubines. How they got to that policy is something I'm going to omit for the sake of time, because there are stages they go through in the first 100 years, but then they end up with this, and it's kind of complicated. So these royal concubines, as I mentioned in reference to Hürrem, were highly trained, and once they entered their career, they were accorded a good deal of status, especially if they were mother of a prince. If you were the mother of a princess, you never had any sons, you still had a good deal of status, but the mother of a potential heir is a particular case. And now let me tell you why royal concubines were only to have one son. And if they had a daughter and a daughter, fine, if the Sultan wanted them, he could call her back. If she had a son, that was it. The reason both her life to the success of her son, right? If all males are eligible, all males deserve their own mother. Their mother is a great political ally. So if you have two sons, which one are you going to support? You're supposed to completely do it. Okay. So the career of the concubine mother is defined as a partnership with her son, right? Not the father. Not a partnership with her. Her partnership with the father is now gone. She's still loyal to him. He still communicates with her about the son and so forth. Hürrem will not have that partnership. Her partnership will remain throughout her life a partnership with the son. Sultan. This is a problem for people. A problem for people. So this is what Hürrem would have been trained to expect. It wasn't what would happen to her. That when her son reached maturity, the oldest it was 15, 16, by Suleiman's reign, at 18, 19, 20, the son would be sent out from the capital, having had all of his training, he would be sent to a provincial capital where he would learn how to govern, and his mother would be the head of his domestic council. That was what she was being trained to do. There she would, and he would have plenty of male advisors that his father had appointed as well, she would help him prepare for the contest with his brothers and their mothers. And she has a counterpart mother. So she would be preparing him to succeed his father. So now we come to the succession, and I'm sorry I have to take you through this kind of sometimes very bloody situation. You need to do it. If everybody's equal, you get to succession. How do you prevent conflict? How do you prevent armed conflict among the brothers? It could happen if the father, if the Sultan is getting old, and you know, maybe he's not, people are starting to think, man, it's not for him to retire. You know, maybe one of these breaking princes. Or he's becoming, you know, a little ill, they start charging. You know, they start slipping into position, gathering arms, gathering supporters, getting money, so forth. Or if a Sultan dies suddenly, then there is the potential for civil war to break out. This is a formula that could lead to sort of, you know, periodic, you know, perpetual kind of wars of the roses. I mean, I'm even thinking Richard III. It's a different system here, but it's, you know, sort of chaotic. Suleiman had no problem. He did not have a problem because he was his father's only surviving son. Asterisk, if somebody wants to ask about why he's the only surviving son. But I'm not going to do it now. But as a prince, he was a prince for, when did they send him out? No, 9, 15, 20. Okay, so he had 11 years. He was his father, he observed his father's own process to the sultanate, and he helped it because his father sitting on the first relied on him to kind of hold the fort when he was out doing stuff. Sinan the First was rather upset with his father. He thought that, I don't have time to go into this, but he thought that he wasn't aware of the threat from Iran. That's just one problem. And he actually left his post and he moved and he basically unseated his father, and rumor says that he had his father poisoned on the way to retirement, and then he went out and cleaned up all of the agony lines, and he, Suleiman, the only one that was left. So it is possible that Suleiman watched and was drawn into one of the bloodiest erasures of fraternal lines in Ottoman history, and I think possibly it's the bloodiest. I don't want to sit down and count up the number of the Civil War in the 15th century. But Suleiman observed that. So he had this peaceful succession, but I think, how could you not suppose this if you're writing the story, that he had to be thinking about this whole system. He just had to be thinking about this whole system. I spend a lot of time in the book, my two most fraught chapters, this is one of them, where I really had to kind of ponder, and let the reader ponder, and come to a decision. My son said to me early on, Mom, you cannot, I'm sorry, I have to tell you this, he reads my chapters. He said, you cannot waffle on this. This is a popular book. Smart people. He said, you have to be the decider with a capital D. And then my great editor, Laura Heimer, I just pay homage to her, she said, could you please make up your mind? And okay, so I have to do this, and you can read the book. Then I did think about this, I think a lot about this. Okay, so he's coming to the throne, he's just lived through all this, enter Hürrem into. I don't know what he's doing. And the rules are broken. And I think I just want to make a list here of the rules that are broken. Or the rule, when I say rule, they are traditions, they are precedents. But I have to say that tradition really almost has the force of law. Made the difference between law and strong traditions. Overlapping. So she has these multiple children and five sons. Three of them are eligible for the throne. One dies in toddlerhood, and one is born with a physical defect, which disqualifies him from eligibility. So already you have the loyalty issue. She has three sons who have been prepared. Three sons, okay? Marriage and freedom that I told you about. She never leaves Istanbul to go to the provinces. with her son. She doesn't have that. I'm going to talk about that process and what that means for a woman's sort of generational statuses. She doesn't leave Istanbul to accompany her son. And she moves. This is important, and if I forget to tell you why this is so significant, Jamie will remind me of it.
About what? Oh, yes.
So at some point after her marriage, she will move from here, the old palace, and she will take up residence in the heart of, it's today the Tokoko Palace, but in that day it's called the Old Palace. The New Palace, because this was the Old Palace, that is an all-male environment. It is the seat of government. It is where the Imperial Treasury is. It's where the Imperial Council meets. It is the seat of government, and women don't enter. But she comes to live in apartments that are built, maybe for her, right next to Suleiman. Not in the male section, but a sort of new wing in Burgess. And over time, that will be probably the most significant thing that happens. Okay. So again, I have to ponder in the book why all of these things happen. They were piecemeal. They happen sort of one by one. One seems to have led to the next. Well, the big question is this a love story, or is this a story of political, purposeful political innovation, or is it a story of sort of happenstance innovation? All of these things are to talk about. Okay.
Can I just tell a little story?
So I was reading my dissertation and on this topic, and the sort of prevailing, it hadn't been studied really, so the prevailing news was Suleiman was just besotted with her, and she was sort of like, it was love, love, love. And I wrote that it was policy. So in my dissertation defense, Michael Cook, one of my teachers, said, so what about love? And I'm like, oh, come on. You know, I tried to ask. And one of my colleagues in Sean Marmon had made a beautiful cartoon. Remember the show Love Boat? And it was how I was reaching out to her and getting her off the love boat. But I have to say, that was, you know, being an academic, right? And I really have to think about this. I have to think about all of these issues here. Okay, so that is the kind of survey of the things that happened with Hürrem, to Hürrem, by Hürrem. So to finish this discussion of family and sovereignty, I need to point out that Suleiman already had a family. Hürrem was not his first concubine. Now, if you can call the triad of sultan, concubine, concubine mother, and son a family, I'm calling it a family. He doesn't have a family there. During the time that he was a prince, princes are given the responsibility of reproducing the dynasty. So as soon as they go out, they're expected. Have their own children. They're the ones that are now populating the dynasty. He had three, possibly more sons. I say possibly more because those who might have died in infancy don't get into the record. Two, tragically, died during the first year of his reign. So he was left with one child from that earlier period whose name was Mustafa. And I think maybe I'm going to talk about Mustafa later, but I'll just slip ahead. I'm going to try this. Suleiman, and this is Mustafa. And I'm going to return to this for the iconography. Yes, it's backwards, and the Tokoko Palace standard to me backwards. Yes, so it's not my fault. And I panicked, and my production editor says, we can flip images, don't worry. Sorry. Okay. So I want to come back to this because you can see that they look almost identical, which is really very interesting. So I just want to show you the stuff up there, and now what I want to do. So Mustafa and his mother are a classic example of this team of concubine mother and son. They are a team. They're a classical unit here. His mother's Ottoman name is Mahi Devran. She came in over the course of his public career. She came in for consistent praise as a good political mentor. And again, it's the Venetians who are saying she's a good mother, she tells him how to make himself be loved by the people. And in the end, when his life is threatened, she tells him all he needs to do is you can be careful about what he eats. And so there are all these, you know, mentions of she's the model. She's a model mother here. And that's from Mustafa, and again, this is coming from the Venetians, because there really are only observant sources at this point. The Ottomans don't write this very much. From the age of 12 or so, you start to hear about Mustafa becoming very popular among the military. That would be the military stations in Istanbul, namely the Janissaries, that they thought that he was going to be a good successor. Okay. So I am just going to jump to the denouement here. I should say, to get to the denouement, that this young man, I am still going ahead, Mehmed, the firstborn of Hürrem and Süleyman's sons, was very promising, and he was popular too, not to the degree that Mustafa was. But he died tragically of the plague at the end of his first year, having gone to the provinces without his mother. And so he was no longer in the running, and that left two sons of Hürrem. Okay, so I'm jumping to the end. Süleyman lives a very long life. He's rather like his grandfather. And he began to suffer physical limitations. He had a very serious gout, and people knew about that. There's one story, the campaigns against Iran, he has three campaigns against Iran, a very long campaign. It takes 2 years to get out there, deal with, you know, fight with the Iranians and get back. And his gout was so bad that people could hear, people in the camp could hear him crying, and apparently the viziers mustered up a band and had, I don't know, young soldiers singing and people making music, so they couldn't hear it. So it was obvious that he was not well towards the end there. And so you started to hear reports of rumbles among the military that they were thinking, you know, even to the point that they were thinking maybe they should retire. And Mustafa is in their mind, but one of the princes. So the contest is heating up. Mustafa gets ever more popular, particularly. You hear it reported now by the French and the Venetians. In particular, that people are saying he's going to be. So the end comes from Mustafa. The end comes from Mustafa when the Ottomans are under military and political threat from Iran in the east. This is 1553. It's been heating up. And Süleyman realizes he has to go on this campaign. So. The great fear becomes, as he sets out, that the army is so, the Janissaries in particular, will defect to Mustafa. Mustafa, by the way, is stationed sort of central eastern Anatolia, which is closer to the Iranian border. So the great fear is that the army might just up and defect, reports are coming, that the Ottomans will then go to war with themselves, and the civil war will break out, because Süleyman's forces, household forces, are probably not under deserting, some people are going to go over, and you may have a civil war opening up between father and son. And the empire will now be open to invasion from the west. Any opportunity for Ferdinand of Austria. Is Ferdinand his name? Yes, he's still Ferdinand of Austria to move into Hungary and try to get into London. That's what happened. So Süleyman orders that his oldest son be executed on his way to his campaign in 1553. This is the moment that Hürrem's reputation is blackened, at least in certain circles, because she is held, particularly by the faction that support Mustafa and Mahi Devran, to be guilty along with Süleyman. I'm going to read you the second couplet of a Marseillaise, of a lament, of a, an elegy for the dead prince. And it's addressed to Süleyman. And Russian here refers to that. She's from Rus, right? You allow the words of a Russian witch into your ears. Deluded by tricks and deceit, you did the bidding of that spiteful hag. You slaughtered that swaying cypress. Fruit of life's orchard. What has the merciless monarch of the world? What has the merciless monarch of the world done to Sultan Mustafa? And that is the refrain of every couplet there. Another elegy written by the soldier poet Yahya was so famous that apparently soldiers were memorizing it. This is a culture that has a very strong formal. So that's the story there. And we leave Hürrem, she will die in 1558, not knowing which of her two sons will succeed. There will be another bloody battle, and Sedan will succeed, but she dies without knowing which one of them, at least she knows one of her sons. So, having now taken, I'm moving to a last section of my talk here, having taken you through this sort of these crisis moments in the Ottoman political system, I want to turn to some more sort of positive or domestic issues. But I do want to say that the fruit of this system with the first 10 sultans through Suleiman is that it turns up very well qualified men to occupy the throne. So you've got a range of 10 very strong sultans, strong in different ways. And it's one of the things that then allowed the Ottoman Empire to become what it was. But the main point of going through all this, at least for Hürrem's story, is the epilogue, and I want to tell you what changed, because I've made the claim that her her and Suleiman's relationship was a game changer, or at least it set possibilities, it opened possibility for things to change. So going to the end of the process, by the second decade of the 17th century, a whole new system of succession will have evolved. And the system is the automatic succession of the eldest living male dynasty. So instead of father to son, I mean, you can look at an Ottoman family tree and go straight down to the first 12 or so, and then it just goes haywire. Uncle, I don't know, nephew, brother. I mean, it just, whoever is the eldest. This, they call it seniority. Seniority is the term we use in English. It preserves, as you can see, it preserves the principle that everybody has a shot at sovereignty. It's just going, you know, down the line here. So the result of this is, and I think everybody would agree, it's kind of a mixed bag of rulers. You don't get these great warrior, politically savvy, culturally alive sultans. But I want to say that, you know, heroic sultans, I'm going to call this the heroic period through Suleiman, just to make it clear, the heroic period, are no longer as necessary. And I want to speak about treaties. I mean, trying to get the students to realize treaties mean, you know, you may have decided you don't want to fight anymore, you can't win. So you make a treaty and you make a settlement, you hope the treaty holds. By 1550 or so, through 1580, I will say, when the treaty was made with Spain to kind of settle business in the Mediterranean, treaties are being made. That doesn't mean the Ottomans have stopped fighting. Anybody else has stopped fighting. But you know, it seems to me a recognition that they have reached their natural limits. It's going to be incredibly expensive now to try to gain any gain against Iran. They can raid each other's territories, and nobody seems to be able to change the basic territorial dominions. And the same in the ocean, in the Mediterranean Ocean, and the same on land with the Austrian Habsburgs. So it makes kind of a sense that the system would change. This takes 60 years for the progressive modifications to take hold to get to this new system. But I think in the book I sort of trace through in the epilogue what sit in the successor to Suleiman, what the next one did, what the different changes were. So I think Suleiman's successor has generally come in for not a great press. We're waiting for somebody do a rehabilitation study of him. I deserves it from this point of view. And he followed some patterns that his parents, I'm going to be just here, his parents followed. He made other innovations. He didn't solve all the problems. And then gradually the problems of, you know, are you going to have a lot of brothers? Are you going to kill them? So you work that out and you get to this whole system. So I wrote in the book, and I this isn't a great brilliant idea, but that this reign of Hürrem and Suleiman from this point of view seems to be a hinge between two parts of the empire. And I, from the point of view of dynastic politics and ideology, the first half I called heroic, and I don't know what to call this. I don't know what to call this all of a sudden. So I called it sustaining for now. I think Bucky Kiss John might call it constitutional. Two French scholars who have written about interregnums call up to Suleiman the game of God. And after this, people have used your game of God, sort of involving, I think, a reference to part of it is divine mercy, divine favor. Okay, do I have 1 minute? 20 more minutes?
About five, I guess.
Yeah,
I was supposed to remind you about the harem as well.
Yes, yeah. Okay, so I just want to turn now to two other aspects of Hürrem's life that were prompted by sort of the aspects of this program in family, kinship and household. And I want to say a little bit about generation and sexuality here, generation and sexuality. So I'm going to go back to this classic concubine and talk a little bit more about sexuality and generation in the concubine career. So the concubine becomes a mature female, you know this now, when she graduates with her son. She's a post-sexual female, right? Her son. She's a professional mother. I decided to use that term, professional mother. One signifier is that she is now an adult in the system, is that she is eligible to build a mosque. A mosque is usually the lead structure in a larger charitable foundation. And she does this in her son's presence. Post-sexual women have greater wisdom. They have voice. And I'm just going to tell you a little example about how I realized that I was expected to have voice when I hit middle age. I spent a lot of time in Turkey, and I realized that, oh my God, what I've been studying historically is probably pretty true. And this was sort of an altercation on a bus between two men, and I happened to be squashed and standing there. And some woman said, say something. I'm like, me? I'm going to have your meeting this here? No! And I'm like, yeah, I meant to say something, I'm going to lose your voice. And an old friend of mine at the outset, where I did my Peace Corps service, she said, yes, sir, Sagibi. How would you translate that? Possessor of the voice, master of the voice. I mean, there's always a voice here. Okay. So Hürrem never achieves that status, right? She doesn't get to leave. She's still presumed to be a sexual being. She has a problem here. It's a sort of unspoken conundrum of her status. Süleyman gets to demonstrate his generational changes. She doesn't really get to do this. And I just want to go to that image. You know, here you see him instructing his son. They're in a kind of a private library. Süleyman, he's a poet, by the way. So maybe he's doing poetry, or is he doing his goldsmithing? He's in the library here, his books are about. And he's having a conversation with Mehmed. And you know, this is a later, this is 1580s, when people look back. And you can see him training his son. And here again, Mustafa, every time he went on a campaign to Iran, he summoned each one of his sons who were stationed there, and they would come and have a kind of a confab with him. He hears from them about what's going on in their local territories, he talks to them, he gives them advice, he says, my son be a good, you know, all that kind of thing. Okay. Since I have this up here, this is not apropos of the point I'm making now, but I wonder, because I haven't read the text, pardon me, the permission. But I could try to get to that, is that the fact that he is so similar to his father in body position and everything, the only difference is the sort of orangey versus the yellowish color of the sort of underdress, is that a recognition that he had the qualities that his father had, or that, you know, he was too ambitious and he would be his father? I am not sure I read the book. Okay, so back to Süleyman. So Süleyman did have opportunity to show his generational changes, but Hürrem didn't have an automatic opportunity. However, she prevailed, or Süleyman prevailed, but I think she prevailed. So I want to turn to this last aspect of her life, and this is her philanthropy, and I will do this in 5 minutes. She was in, towards the end of the 1530s, apparently given permission. The Europeans tell a story about how she finagled permission to build her own mosque. And she needed to do this because it would be a public statement of her stature. So when she does it, or when she and Süleyman plan it, or when Süleyman says, okay, I give you authorization here, the Mufti, the religious authority, also has to give authorization, she becomes the first royal woman to build a mosque complex in Istanbul, in the capital. So once again, she breaks a huge kind of, I guess, precedent. And I should just say that she sets the model for the queen mothers, for the princesses to come. Süleyman is very generous, or he is very happy to have the women of his family become builders. His sister Shah Sultan was very interested in sort of mystical Islam, and she established three sort of centers in Istanbul, and she probably did more outside Istanbul. So Hürrem wasn't the only one, but she does this. And I'm going to show you the images now. This is an older aerial photograph, so you can just see what it looks like from the air. Here is the mosque, and now I will show you a better image to show you what it consisted of. Here you'll notice, oops, here you'll notice that the mosque is a single dome. It's a very modest mosque. The mosque was modest, and that was probably a reflection of the fact that her status, you know, she can't build a great big mosque at this point in her life. She's just newly emerging. But the area grew, and by the early 16th century, the congregation grew, so they set up, you know, they added a whole new area to the mosque. That's why it's double dome in the other one. These were the first two buildings to be constructed. This is a primary school. It's for children of the neighborhood. I'm really interested to know whether girls would have been included, and it's hard to know, and so it's in the book. This is a madrasa. This is where young students would be trained in the religious sciences, in law, various other things. And it's a very elegant madrasa. Each student had his own room, had his private. So, and then this is the third component. It is a very large soup kitchen. The soup kitchen would feed all the employees, the students of the complex, all the people who work in the mosque, and it also fit the poor of the neighborhood. And then later, when Suleiman was building his own great foundation, and he builds a hospital, she also builds a hospital. She adds a hospital here. And there's wonderful stuff about the charter deed. There's wonderful things she says in the charter deed about how she wants her doctors to be very sort of humane, not just good doctors, but really nice. So I like that very much. So that is her foundation.
Do I have more I want to show?
Just really quickly, this is a late 16th century map of the imperial city here, and you can always find our mosque because it was built in one of the Byzantine forums. This is a forum of Arcadius, and there was a statue of Arcadius here. And so visitors could find it because they could find this. All visitors, at least European visitors, knew about Byzantine history, and they knew where the Byzantine forums were. So there you go. I want to say just a couple last things about this, about her philanthropy. This was the first thing she did. It was fairly modest, at least the mosque. By the end of her life, she had foundations or smaller religious-oriented services in Jerusalem, Mecca, Medina, other cities, the small towns. Among the things that she sponsored were mosques, madrasas, and primary schools. That's kind of a general formula. Soup kitchens, hostels for travelers and religious pilgrims, lodges for Sufis, places where Sufis could come together, shrines for saintly figures, public baths, and a hospital, and this is quite modern for its day. I want to make the point that this is not just the greater glory of the donor and the builder, it got her a lot of glory, but these foundations are magnets, can be magnets for urban renewal. This was an area that was completely devastated or underpopulated and suffering, and robbers were, you know, setting up dens. And so these foundations out from the center city really helped urban renewal. You know, they provided a lot of jobs. They provided a lot of jobs, and people want to move in the neighborhood for the amenities. She provided fresh water and so forth. So I'm coming to my conclusion here. Is that it's difficult to prove, but I am persuaded that it won her, all of these charitable acts won her, a level of respect and approval that probably outweighed the criticism. The criticism may have been sort of centered in Istanbul, European sources, and we don't hear the praise that she might have come in for, but I am sure she was recognized as a great philanthropist. As I said, European diplomats don't mention this, but we do, and I want to end with this. We do have one record of an emissary from Mecca who mentions her philanthropy. And I'm going to read this as a kind of an epilogue for Hürrem. I'm calling him Kutbeddin al-Makki. He is in Istanbul in the months March, April, May, and she dies in April of that year, so he's there. And he has a hard time getting to see the people he needs to see. Everybody is just shut down, and Suleiman won't see anybody, won't talk, because he's grieving, which is quite ill. So he writes about her, and I do it at the end of the book before the epilogue. He writes kind of an epitaph, and I'm going to read the whole thing. But I like that he first notices the charity. He says, there are many charitable foundations and good works of hers in the noble sanctuaries and other cities. It is said that she was Russian by origin. Because she pleased the Sultan, he married her. And in this way, the deceased finally achieved the status she held. She influenced the Sultan to the degree that the state of many affairs lay in her hands. So her power is there for this man to mention. She had many children. They are Selim, Bayezid, Mehmet, Jihangir, and the Lady Sultan. He will not name Russia. As long as their mother lived, these siblings got along well, but after her death, discord arose among them. It is said that her name was Hürrem Sultan. The Sultan loved her to distraction, and his heart was broken. And I like to think that what was happening in Istanbul becomes trendy among elite Muslims, in cities around the empire and then the whole trickle down effect. So I can't prove that, but I think she probably is a trendsetter there. But in terms of what happened when she moved into the new palace, is that she had a retinue that went with her. And she had her own, I don't know how large, you know, sort of cadre of unit. I mean, there was a kind of an area that she occupied. Well, by the end of the 16th century, it's become very large. It's moved around into a part of the palace that is parallel with other parts of the palace. It's quite a large institution. And by the middle of the 17th century, even the early 17th century, you had women now acting as regents for younger sons. So she sets a very important precedent, and the imperial harem in palace itself becomes a wing of government. And one other, I didn't talk about this at all, but I'm just saying one sentence, is that I am more and more convinced that I knew that she carried on correspondence with Polish kings and with one of the Iranian princesses, kind of both peacemaking leaders, but I discovered a different, with the help of a Polish graduate student, a different correspondence that she carried on with a female member. So she created, I think, or she certainly pushed forward a whole epistolary channel of female diplomacy. And her successors were writing with and exchanging gifts with Queen Elizabeth, to the Queen, Catherine de' Medici, so it was quite a point for me. And I think she was a female. So she broke through and set up.
You field your own?
Yeah, so thank you for the presentation. I was I was really fascinated by this idea that you said of a post-sexual female. So I was wondering if you could say a few more words about that and why she wasn't in many ways able to ever achieve that status.
Why are people calling her a witch? Why are they saying she bewitched him with potions and spells? I mean, it's because they assume he's still sleeping with her and he's just sexually raised in love with her. And I mean, she doesn't have that protection. Now that's coming from Europeans, but apparently it's coming from the street too, okay? Because the word they quote is jadet, you know, which is a Turkish. And I think that she's still there. And now she's moved into the palace after she gets married, marrying her. So there's assumption that she hasn't moved on to a political career. She's very political. She's incredibly political. She's raising these boys. We have her letters. This is not the post-sexual part. She's very political in that palace. But people know the old pattern. And so she just hasn't moved to the next stage of female maturity. Maybe I can say a little bit more about that, because I wrote about that. 40, this is rather simplistic, but 40 is a powerful age for men in Islamic tradition. The Prophet Muhammad, presumption that sexual activity is no longer a requisite. You don't need to be producing the next generation. And so you see, I mean, Suleiman changes. You know, he starts wearing less magnificent clothes. He becomes a little more observant of Islamic, protocols or stops drinking wine at some point. And so he's settling into kind of a new phase. And you can see that, 1536. I mean, it's a new, he starts building in Jerusalem. You see him turning his attention to the Islamic wing, you know, the Islamic side. He's spending money there and with charitable enterprises. And so you can see, people can see the Sultan moving into that phase. Now, that doesn't mean that he and Hürrem weren't sleeping together, but they have to sort of, you have to show that you aren't, that it's not a preoccupation of your life. So I think there is sort of a broader cultural sense that, you know, when you reach a certain age, and that's when you are no longer, you have to have your household. And she doesn't get that. She doesn't get her own household. You know, she doesn't get, because she doesn't get to go with her son. So she's, does that make sense? I mean, she's at that phase. Now, she's only going to be 35 or so at that point, but still, her son's a grown up. I think there may be some tension, too, because Mehmed is rather late. He's 20 when he goes into the field. And I think there was a lot of thinking about, why isn't that boy out? Mustafa's out. Why isn't that boy out? And there are a lot of people who would like that young man to go to the front, because he takes his whole household. So all kinds of people are going to get, you know, plum jobs when they go with him and Israel. And he will send, his mother will assemble a harem for him. So all kinds of things. So that isn't happening. And I think that's part of the problem. I mean, why do we hear that Bewitched? He was deeply in love with her. He was passionate. Constantly
being
repeated, you never hear that. Does that help, or do you
want to
push further?
No, that helps. Thank you.
Yeah. So I can't prove it. It's just this street talk. And, Carter, and then the person.
Can you say anything about the volume of letters that you have from her? I mean, the idea of her correspondence is so fascinating. How much of it is there?
Thank you for asking, because the letters I didn't talk about at all, the letters are wonderful. Okay, I only have my hands on, I know what Chagatai, I'm just speaking in person, Chagatai Uluchai is transliterated, those, and those are in my hands. So I tried to get as many copies as, but you can only from Tokapa at this point, get letters in any torrent number, you know.
Yeah.
So I got those. So, and I will tell you what I learned from that, and other torrent numbers don't match, but I think I have. And the good thing is they date from 1526, when Suleiman is off on a great big campaign, to a letter, this is so sad, a letter she writes after the execution of Mustafa that she doesn't know her own son, Jihangir, is diagnosed. So there's a couple of frantic letters, quasi-frantic letters that are being written when she knows Mustafa's been executed. You can tell she's doubting that she's about that. So I have those. We have copies of the correspondence with Poland. Do you mean letters to Suleiman? All letters. We have copies of that, and so we know that she wrote at least two letters to Sigismund I, and Sigismund his heir, but I did find that she had correspondence with Isabella, who is their daughter, and regional queen of Transylvania. That's brilliant. I'm not going to talk about that one. So the letters are great. The letters are wonderful. I don't know how many there were. I mean, she's obviously having epistolary correspondence with Suleiman, so I think there are a whole lot that did not survive or that simply have not been kept. No, I think they did not survive.
Mm-hmm.
And none of it does. But you can tell that there are issues. You just asked me this. Or, I'm really sorry, my budget ran out. I didn't mean that. You know, thank you for sending me the money. So you can tell that there are a lot. Yes.
Thank you. I'm such a big fan of the Turkish soap opera Muhteşem Yüzyıl, and I think so much is love. And you said you feel that you need to look further into, are we talking about love? And I think my curiosity stems from this idea that romantic love or courtly love comes about in Europe much later. It's not really something people are talking about or doing at the level of the court, right? I mean, these are arranged marriages. It's about dynasty. So what about the possibility that this was just that Suleiman was in love?
I think courtly love is quite thriving in France and England in this period. And sometimes I wonder I just wonder, I'm not sure I even put this in the book, but there is and Suleiman, he's in great competition with you. I'm going to get back to love. He's in great competition, not only politically on the Mediterranean with the great House of Habsburg, Charles V in Spain, Ferdinand in Austria, but he's also an ideological competition, and it's over the mantle for Rome. You know, who can claim Rome? This becomes quite an issue in the 1530s when Charles V is crowned or is on the emperor. So, but Suleiman is watching. I don't know how much he's watching England, but it's, we go to 1 o'clock, how much time do we have?
We haven't told one.
Yeah, okay, so I can spin this out a little bit. It's really interesting to me that the dates with marrying Hürrem, there are internal reasons for why he has to marry her. He's headed off from Iran, and I think there are all kinds of strategic reasons, and she probably wants him to marry her because, you know, what he's killed out there and stuff. But these are the dates when Anne Boleyn is being married and then executed. It is that he executes his grand vizier Ibrahim, who is a great stylist of his magnificent fame, just the year or two before Thomas Cromwell is executed. I know some of the parallels here make me think that even if the English aren't there yet in the empire, they won't come to the end of the century, that he's quite aware of what's going on. I mean, he has channels, and he also has these resident Venetian ambassadors who know everything because their ambassadorial system is very sophisticated. So I'm getting to the point here. I wonder if he thought it would be a cool thing to have a queen. In this age of king and queen. I mean, count the kings and queens. And I don't know about that. I mean, Hürrem might have, like, hey, I want to be like that, you know? And here she's in correspondence with Isabella. And I just have to now say this. Isabella of, okay, I'm going to talk about Isabella because her mom is so cool. And if you have a mom in here, am I making any sense? Isabella is the daughter of Sigismund I. She is married to this John Zapolya. When Suleiman makes him vassal of Hungary, when he first gets part of Hungary, he dies. And so there's this little baby and his mother, Isabella, and what's going to happen? And is Isabella going to be able, is her son going to have the crown? And okay, I'm not going to get into that whole story, but Suleiman is like, no, but we'll give you a prize. You can be the regent of Transylvania. I found correspondence. I found a letter. I was given a letter of Hürrem to Isabella, and it is just, I'm going to mess it all up. She writes, and this is a Latin translation, because it would have gone through dragomans, you know, one language to another, and she's pushing for Isabella to stay loyal. This is a letter, this is female diplomacy saying, stick with us Ottomans, because the other issue is probably going to go with Habsburgs. They have to either pick the Ottomans or pick the Habsburgs, at this point. You can't be neutral when you're in that area. And she says something like, Filia Carissima, dear daughter, and it goes on and it says things like, I just love this, for many people know. Something like, we are both daughters of Eve. And so we worship the same God. But she said, we are both loyal subjects of the Sultan. So she goes on with her little political propaganda here. And you're like, wow, you know, I didn't know that, but it's in some secondary source. And then I don't think she has correspondence with Isabella's mother, who is Bona Sforza from the House of Sforza in Milan. Bona Sforza, if you look her up, how come we don't know about these Central European queens? Really, it's just, maybe you do, and Ohio State. Maybe you do, I don't know. Bona Sforza was an incredibly powerful wife of Sigismund I. She introduced the Renaissance. Just look her up on Wikipedia or anywhere. She's really interesting. So, Isabella, Bona was partial to the Ottoman side. This isn't about love, is it? I got really away from love. But, but this was.
It was political anyway.
Bona Sforza gets. She supports Bona Sforza, and Bona Sforza makes these pro Ottoman movements. So it's really a great story that I hadn't photographed soon. I don't know what happened. Anyway, love. Okay, I'm going to introduce something else, which I cut out for the interest of time, and I'm going to tell you what it's like working with a trade publisher. This is a trade publisher, but it's kind of, they publish academics. But my editor, who became publisher with capital P, bought it for herself. She said she didn't get to do many women's studies. So she read my whole first draft, and this is about Roxana's attitude, Hürrem's attitude towards being a sex slave, we should call it. She said this woman is a sex slave. Respect the sensibilities of your modern reader. She is a sex slave. How do you know she wanted to sleep with Suleiman? I had raised that issue in another chapter with Mahi Devran, and I was talking about her, saying, you don't know how these women felt at the beginning. You know, when did they feel any affection for the Sultan? Did they hate this whole? They certainly probably had a better life than they would have at home. They're mostly cousins from rural areas. You know, they probably would have died younger, and maybe they would marry off to some awful man, or, you know. So they were taken care of, but did they want this job? And she also said to me, you know, maybe she never wanted another son. And this idea that she, you know, maybe she didn't want to go back. Maybe she was happy to just have that career and be like all these other women and get her life organized that way. And so I had to think about that more, and I really didn't spell that out in the book. But then I started to think about what bonds would they have? As you say, it may not be affective. Is that what you were saying? You know, we don't have to assume love is love. And they thought, you know, you've had all these children together. You lose one. She comes into his life when he's just lost two children. He's lost three because he lost his only daughter. Babies. And then he calls her back. And, I mean, she must know his state of mind. She's got this baby. She has a future. She's part of a family. His mother is now, you know, caring for her. So, you know, they may not be bonds of love, but maybe sort of used to each other. And then when you see her, not her first letters, they're quite formal. She doesn't dictate them. She always has a scribe, I can tell you. That's why I needed to see the original copies. She always has a scribe. But they get you know that she's dictating at some point. So, you know, after a while, you get a sense that she really, really is worried about him. She's always fussing. So I don't know if that's love, but it's certainly a deep relationship, probably developed over time. And then the relationship is fraught politically. She's, you know, what is she talking about their sons? You know, she says, let's not have any more kids, let's do birth control. You know, you wonder what these conversations were. No, two sons, three sons, four sons, five sons. I mean, what did she want? Did she want to be pregnant after her first whatever years? Mm-hmm. So I didn't raise those questions. Does that help?
Oh, very much so. Thank you.
At some point, she's politically desperate for him not to die and for one of her sons to succeed. But I think she cares deeply about him. She is so upset when he has gout. And I think it's sincere. Okay. Yes?
I was wondering, I wanted to hear a little bit more about the particularities of her anxiety with Mustafa's execution. What is the correspondence like in and around that between the two of them?
You don't see much. The question, I'm going to change the question. I'm going to come back to that particular letter. And it won't be just about Mustafa, it's about the aftermath. When Suleiman sets up, he wasn't going to go in his camp because he's really gouty and old. And his grand vizier gets up to Central Anatolia and says, things are heating up around Mustafa. People are saying, you better get out here. He's a traitor. And Suleiman says, I'm afraid he's a traitor. You know, these are just the people who want him to be the Sultan. He knows the story. And so then he dies. So she's worried about her. Whether she knows he's going to execute Mustafa when he leaves,
right.
I don't know. There are no letters there saying, what are you going to do? I'm sorry. How's my son? Because he's got to meet with the other sons on the way.
Right.
I don't know if she knows. We can't know if she knows.
Right.
I can come back. Okay, I will go to the Venetians again, who are very interested in all this, and this is when she meets up in her story again. And they say, well, she can be assumed to be pushing for her own sons, like Mustafa's mother is pushing for him. But she's savvy enough, I forget the word here, to know that she can't be bugging Suleiman all the time, you know, and the implication is he's not going to listen to her anyway because he's got to be Solomonic, that's what his name is, Suleiman. And so I don't know what she knows, and you have to assume that she's right there, you know, she can talk about something and revise it, you know, and Mahi Devran doesn't have it here. She's all next to it. So there's that. So what she knows that Mustafa is a huge threat. And whether she has spies out there, I should probably have spies out there because that's her job. To help her son, she's probably communicating with her son, she's probably
Let me know what's happening. Let me know what you hear. I'm sure this is all going on. Can you, here's something handy. And you can fill this in. But we don't have any letters. The letter, I think, he executes Mustafa October's early October, and he arrives at Aleppo. He's going to carry on, so he has to winter in Aleppo. And she knows, she would have heard right away that Mustafa was executed. The courier would have gone to her right away. And her oldest son is in Europe. There's a practice that you always put a prince out there in the European capital when the Sultan goes east. So he's there, so he's going to go too. He has to know, because he's going to be facing possible. So she knows. But when she writes this letter, she doesn't. Okay. The thing she's worried about is that she has heard, and all of, she's always telling Suleiman what's happening in Istanbul, when the city is, you know, what you need to do, because the city's rumbling, or the city's happier, the city's heading in order. She's giving him news from home. He's her probably best informant after he's been sent to graduate. So she says, there's the city, what is this news about a good news messenger? There's a word that means, you know, a messenger coming from you, bringing good news. She says, you know, I mean, there you are in Aleppo, and it's your winter camp. What can be coming? What can be coming here? You know, what's this all about? And they're decorating the city, and they're saying, oh, yay, great stuff is going to happen. And I'm like, she says, you know, we're being basically getting prepared for a fall here. You know, what's up? And I think that it is probably the messenger that's bringing the news that she ever sent her. But then there are three postcards, and you can tell she's nervous. And one of them is about the Grand Vizier. Who is her son-in-law, by the way, who had told Suleiman, you know, there's trouble, and so he gets blamed for the execution. So she gets blamed, he gets blamed, and his wife, her and his daughter, gets blamed. So she has a plea for him. I never see her making a political plea in any of this. She says, you know, be kind to your servant and slave, Rustam Pasha, blah, 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 blah. I think there is a fear, possibly, that the Janissaries are the other soldiers. So angry that they are going. Suleiman has sent him into exile. They wanted him executed right after the death. They called for his head. And she sent him to his wife's palace in exile, big exile. She says, you know, don't listen to the soldiers. For my sake, for your daughter's sake, for your sake, Suleiman, you know, basically don't do anything to this American. So you see her very worried.
Oh, yeah. No, that's great.
So that letter is like, yeah. And how many letters did we miss that it would have been a different book? A whole different book.
And I love the notion of she being his eyes, because that's new too, right? Mm-hmm. That hadn't been before, that he has all kinds of advantages in this relationship that previous sultans hadn't had, right? And this is a new power relationship that benefits him as well. Because she's there in the seat, either way.
I don't think it's that new. I don't know what happened in Constantinople, but they stayed so much, much larger than you have Istanbul, which is the Neo-Italian Empire. And you've moved, you know, Mehmed the Conqueror doesn't move right away, but he does move to Istanbul for 10 years. And he's got his sisters, his mother, he's got high level women.
Right.
He's a highly educated women.
Right.
And that hair. I mean, I think a lot about, you know, the gatherings they might have had with elite women, the wives of officers and viziers who've gone to war. It would even certainly be called, you know, like women's networks, I think, are very, very so where was I going with that? So, did he have his mother? So you have those women. Suleiman's mother was brilliant. I mean, I wrote along with that a lot for her. I could not. She went through all that business with him. She was married. She went through all that business, and the Venetians talk about her and how he had great respect for her, and he writes her personally, and he has a victory. And we know who some of her agents were. She sends an agent. I don't know what the agent was, very interesting. She sends an agent to a Venetian diplomat to find out exactly where the Ottoman army was during the siege of Bulhaks. This is 1526. She sends this agent. So she's using, you know, she's getting involved. She's in.
Yeah.
So they've had that before. But I don't know if the intimacy with Hürrem, the fact that, you know, there's so much news she has to convey. She's always talking about the young man who's handicapped. I don't think it's a Chihang Yir. Because he has operations. I don't know. She's writing about his health. So she has all these things. But she wasn't first. But she might have been. Possibly in that quarter system. He may be a Sultan. He certainly was a Sultan who wanted to write to his wife. We don't know if Sam wrote billions of letters. Or, you know, so it would be a Suleiman. Anyway, there you go.
First of all, thank you so much for your talk. I really enjoyed it. So you mentioned how Europeans, what they thought about Hürrem. And I was wondering if there's any sense about whether later Ottoman sources, whether you can get a sense of what, you know, later Ottomans thought about, you know, as exceptional, the figure as her. And, you know, I was just wondering if there's any sense.
I want to answer about her. I guess I want to answer the whole historiography of was she evil or was she not evil? Was she responsible for the decline of the Ottoman Empire or was she not? You don't, because that's how bad it is. Women in eunuchs. When I started that before, you know, it was the whole decline and it was decline after Suleiman. And then I think our generation. The sultans became palace sultans. They didn't go out anymore. You know, this is, you know, America, great empire. I mean, so then I think we just started asking about what transformation meant. You have another 300 years of this empire survives. So you have, interestingly, she's accused of other executions that Suleiman has chosen to do, and one is his first grand vizier, Ibrahim Pasha. And there is no evidence that I can find in anything that she, so I exonerate her from that. And I have to go into all of these things she got accused of. So I'm getting tired. Where are we going? So by the end of the 16th century, we have Mustafa Ali, and there's this biography of him by Cornel Fleischer. And he says that the wife and the son-in-law and the daughters, meaning Hürrem, her daughter Mihrimah, and this was Rustem Pasha, who's, you know, they, in a word or two, you know, they, that was very bad for the Ottoman Empire. You know, it was kind of when they started to go bad. I'm sort of not being precise here. And so he's saying the execution of Mustafa. And he's not saying she did it, but he's saying that faction, that pro-Syrian Bayezid faction, her sons, you know, really was powerful. I'm sure that was true, but he's sort of the first. But then I sort of looked at the 17th century historians, who doesn't get blamed. You know, they don't talk about her. And the argument I make in the book, and I had to do like many drafts of this and get my son on board and get all kinds of people on board, and was to say that, you know, it was Suleiman's decision, it was a political decision, but who knows what kind of oppression there was coming. So I'm going to jump to, you know, later Ottoman historians. I don't look into the 18th century, the 19th century. I do know that when you get to the first sort of historical dictionary, which is in Adi, you know, he has the story a little bit. And he's like, oh, she was the first thing she did was get rid of the grand vizier Ibrahim Pasha. And I'm like, okay, by this period, the whole story is here. And today's, I just had to leave out an enormous footnote because I decided what do I need. I don't want to beat up all my colleagues. But it became sort of routine that, you know, and she was responsible for the whatever Stanford Shaw did not make it. You know, she was sort of responsible for being there. So, and I think that, I don't know, there's a whole study, and a woman who did a PhD in it, Catherine Lemire, and she's a trainee?
Yeah, I know somebody else.
Yeah. Anyway, so, do you want to, did I leave out part of your question?
No, thank you.
Yeah. So, I do want to say that these two poets who wrote the elegies, they were part of Mustafa and Mahi Devran's circle. So you can, and you know, it was a highly literate circle. They were in Amasya city, Amasya, which always had great poets and a lot of patronage for princes. So, you know, some of them. So this historiography of her guilt. I said that what she and Mustafa were both guilty of was suspicion of the capacity to kill. that it was just very easy to feel so much hope. They had so much hope. Fear them.
We have time for maybe one more question?
I have do you think there are materials exist for a study of the old palace and the stuff? You know, there's obviously such an important center, and the female residents until this time for all of them, and until I can act this, the ones who are not. So the retirement home for the palace for them. Prep school and retirement home for the palace for them.
And great training institutions. It was one of the great European
if somebody wanted to do a study of the
I don't know. Nijipol, you'd have to go to Nijipol. It'll be my first to see, because she knows all the inventory, the architectural story. I don't know whether she would know that material. I think you probably could find documents. I don't know. There are enough European references. You could do the old palace over time.
Yeah, I'm not talking about the architectural history of it, but more like institutional.
Yeah, architectural historians, they'll find these data, you know, how
many
women, how much money, what was the budget.
That's
so
right.
They give you all that kind of cool stuff that really allows you to build the palace from the bottom. I think you could, if you know, over time, so many princesses went back there, you know, when their husbands were executed or died or whatever, or they retired there, you know, when they were done with husbands. I think you probably could. But I don't know. I think you could. It would be a lot. I don't know.
Big
maybe you
job,
find
probably.
Fabulous stuff.
Yeah.
Somebody should do it.
I think probably the way in would be through architectural. Doesn't Chidim Kapustu, whose goal is to, doesn't the book have the best visual for the old palace that I personally have? So
it's where I went to find out. Where the column, you know, I went there to find what stones were moved. Yes, she's good. Very early period. I think probably it's a but you want documents. You would go to the archives. You would go to the archives. I can just tell you, I mean, Barkhan has published the salary register for 1555. And I started there with the salary register. So you can see who's going to pay what the budgets are for the kitchen, what the budgets for the clothing expenses. So you've got that information there, and you probably can take that all the way through. Okay, well, thank you all for your questions, and thank you all for-